Hello. So, let me begin today's class with a three-dimensional image, that is a hologram, a 3D virtual image of an object. So, there are different types of holograms and all of them work by recording the interference pattern of light waves which are caused by an object and then recreating that scene when illuminated. Now, looking at this, I do have a question, as in, can interference pattern create a three-dimensional surface of Earth? Well, that is what we are going to find out as part of today's lecture. So, welcome to the second lecture of module 6. Before we move ahead, a quick recap on what we learned in the previous lectures. So, in the last class, we were trying to understand Young's double slit experiment indirectly by using the analogy of sound. And we learned that when two sources, which can be either two receivers or two transmitters, so when these two sources are placed very close to each other, the path length difference shall change as a function of look angle to source. Okay, path length is the path traveled by a wave, and look angle is simply put the angle with which the radar is looking at the surface of Earth. So, we learned that for a wave, a single measurement of phase is not of much use, isn't it? But then, when we compare between two or more phase measurements, they can provide invaluable information about the path length difference, Again, when two sources, which can be a receiver or transmitter, when they are close to each other, the path length difference shall change as a function of look angle, which is given by the following relationship here. Delta L equals d sine theta L, where theta L is nothing but the look angle. Delta L is the path length difference and D is the separation between the two sources. Also, we learned that the phase difference can be written using this relationship. Delta phi phase difference equal to delta L path length difference by lambda wavelength into 2 pi. Again, we shall be getting constructive interference whether the phase difference is say 0, 2 pi, 4 pi or any integer number n of 2 pi's. Now, if we consider only those angles which give a peak in the interference pattern, we can rewrite the expression like this, where theta L, that is the look angle, equal to sine inverse n lambda by d. What is this? This is a maximum and peak which occurs if theta L, lambda and d, that is the separation between the two sources, if they satisfy the following relationship. And remember, in the last lecture, we also learned about interference pattern. What happens when the frequency is changed? What happens when the distance between the two sources are changed? So, by now, we have an understanding that the phase information of a wave can be used to compute a two-way distance. Shown here is a wave to convey the meaning of phase. Phase difference is the difference in phase angle of two waves. So, by looking at the screen in front of you, you can understand that a complete cycle is defined by 2 pi. Isn't it? 360 degrees. And for two-way distance, the phase can be written as phi equal to 2 pi by lambda into 2r. And 2r, remember, is for two-way distance. For the distance that is in one direction, it is going to be phi equal to 2 pi by lambda into r. For two way distance it is 2r because the wave has to travel twice. For passive remote sensing it is going to be r, isn't it? And for active remote sensing like radar remote sensing it is going to be 2r. Okay. So, now we are clear on the fundamental aspects. So, then let me ask you a question. You know, is topographical information possible to be extracted from synthetic aperture radar? Because in the beginning of the lecture I showed you a hologram which gives you a three-dimensional virtual representation of the Earth's surface. Now I am asking you, if two single look complex images from synthetic aperture radar is captured over the same aerial extent, can they be used in some way to generate topographical information, okay, elevation information? The answer is yes, absolutely yes. And we can obtain high resolution topographical information from synthetic aperture radar interferometry, interferometric SAR, abbreviated popularly as Insar, which will be part of today's lecture. So, firstly, let us try to understand what exactly is interferometry. That's a new terminology, isn't it? So, interferometry, simply stated, it is the technique by which the coherent properties of electromagnetic waves are utilized to measure the Earth's surface changes even to the order of centimeters. Think about it, even to the order of centimeters. And to measure the distance between two points which has been traveled by a wave, we tend to count the number of whole wavelengths between two points, isn't it? And of course, we need to know the fraction traveled by the wave as well. For a wave, say we know the phase, but then we don't know the number of full or whole wavelengths traveled in the path length, then the measurement of phase is not useful, isn't it? We know the phase, but we don't know the number of full wavelengths traveled by the wave. Then the information of phase alone is not useful. It doesn't tell us much. Say, we consider an X-band radar system operating at 3 centimeter wavelength. Then an uncertainty in distance would have to be much lesser than 3 centimeter for the phase measurement to make sense. Let me try to reiterate. Say, we are considering an X-band radar system operating at 3 centimeter wavelength. Then an uncertainty in distance would have to be much lesser than 3 centimeter for the phase measurement to make sense, isn't it? Now, in an interferometric SAR or in INSAR, the phase difference between two synthetic aperture radar images of the same area are acquired at different time to create an interferogram which is used to infer ground surface displacements or the range change between two time periods. Now, we will try to understand this through the schematic in front of you. So, towards the left side, you see a single antenna SAR, wherein the return echo can be from anywhere in this circle. Okay? Say we are trying to measure the return echo from this point over here. So, it can be from anywhere in this circle. And towards your right side, you see the schematic for interferometric SAR, INSAR, wherein there are two antennas used, antenna 1 and antenna 2, and they are used to capture information from the same point. Okay? So, the return echo can be from the intersection of circle in red and circle in blue. Interferometric SAR, that is phase difference between two SAR images of the same area are acquired at different time to create something known as an interferogram. And using an interferogram, we are trying to infer about the ground surface displacement between the two time periods. Okay? Fine. But then why to learn about interferometry in this course? Now, INSAR is ideal, as I mentioned before, to measure the surface deformation. And think about the amount of information will be available to us using INSAR in the event of natural hazards like landslides or earthquakes. Of course, there are other techniques like the global positioning system, GPS, or spirit leveling, etc., which can provide us with elevation information, but then they are labor intensive and they cannot cover large aerial extents. Whereas, we use INSAR imagery to cover precise information about surface deformation for broader regions of interest. Okay? When we use INSAR imagery, they can precisely give you surface information over a larger aerial extent, over a broader region of interest. Alright, so what you see towards your right side is one product that is obtained from interferometric techniques, which is indispensable, I would say, for hydrologic and hydrodynamic modeling. They are called as DEMs or digital elevation models. So, interferometric techniques result in generation of digital elevation models, which are created at high vertical precision from the space, making them invaluable for hydrologic and hydrodynamic modeling. So, what exactly are digital elevation models and how they are useful in hydrology will be covered as part of an upcoming lecture. But for now, understand that the color differences show the elevation difference, okay? Elevation difference with respect to a reference surface. Okay? And what you see here is IFSAR Alaska from USGS portal. Alright. Now, let us try to understand a bit more about INSAR, interferometric SAR. Hoping that you remember the example which we used to discuss in the last class about sound waves interacting. So, I am going to use the same example here. Assume the two sources sending coherent electromagnetic waves are from two antennas in space, say antenna 1 and antenna 2. So, the baseline or interferometric baseline refers to the separation distance between the two sources, okay, between the two antennas. The two antennas are separated by distance known as baseline distance, baseline. And the interference pattern can represent the phase difference which is measured from different directions, isn't it? And in the case of synthetic aperture radar, which is on board an aircraft or a satellite, they are going to have a side looking geometry. So, the interference pattern also is going to be generated accordingly. Okay? Shown here is just for representation purposes, so that now you can replace the sources of sound waves. In the same example, you can replace the source by antenna 1 and antenna 2, two sources. Okay, moving on. So, in this diagram, you see the baseline distance, that is the separation distance between the two sources, antenna 1 and antenna 2. The figure shows baseline components along the x axis as well as the component along the y axis, isn't it? Just to let us know that there are different means of denoting the separation distance between two satellites. Either we can use the separation distance along x axis and along y axis, or we can use the baseline distance and alpha, an angle, so that we can denote the separation between the two antennas. A third way is to use the baseline distance, the perpendicular and parallel components of baseline indicated in diagram C. Remember, right now we are speaking about the distance, separation distance between the two antennas. There will also be a time difference between the overpasses, which is referred to as temporal baseline. And this temporal baseline, it can be days, it can be at a sub-daily time scale, that is the time the aircraft takes to fly over the scene, temporal baseline. Okay? So, the separation distance between the two sources, that is the two antennas, they are referred to as baseline distance, and there will also be a time difference between the overpasses, which is referred to as temporal baseline. Okay? So, in today's lecture, I am going to introduce you to few new terminologies, because that is required for us to understand about INSAR, interferometric SAR. Alright, so moving forward, there are different types of radar interferometry. And broadly speaking, there are two main classes of interferometric radars, which are separated based on the geometric configuration of the baseline vector. And they are cross track interferometry and along track interferometry. Okay? In across track interferometry, the antennas are separated in the cross track direction. And in along track interferometry, the antennas are separated in the along track direction, as seen in the schematic in front of you. Remember, the underlying principle of interferometry is that two or more measurements of synthetic aperture radar images, they are taken and they are combined to give more information than what was originally available. And these measurements can either be taken by single antenna or different antennas. Okay? That brings us to our next terminology. I will give this some time to sink in. You can note that the separation in across track interferometry is along the cross track direction, and the separation in along track interferometry is along the along track direction. Now, while you hold that thought, there can also be measurements which are made by a single pass or by repeat pass or multipass. Just to make things clear, single pass interferometry is the measurements that are made using one single flight over the scene, measurements made using a single flight over a scene. And single pass interferometry, it is possible in two modes. Mode 1 is wherein the single platform, it carries two antennas. Okay? Single platform carrying two antennas. And there is transmission from one antenna and measurement of return echoes from both the antennas, mode 1. Okay? Now, there can also be a second mode, mode 2, wherein the transmission and receiving of signals are alternating between each antenna. Transmission and receival of signals are alternating between both the antennas. An example is Tandem X, which is a twin satellite of TerraSar X, that is a German Earth observation satellite. It uses SAR, which has a single pass SAR interferometry configuration, Tandem X. Moving on. Now, for Tandem X, there are different data acquisition modes. Remember the different modes of SAR, similar to that. There are different data acquisition modes for Tandem X. Again, easy to remember terminologies, but I want you to be familiar with these terminologies because they will be required for us throughout this course. Data acquisition modes for Tandem X, they are bistatic acquisition mode, bistatic acquisition mode, wherein the transmitter and receiver are separated by distance, and monostatic mode, where they are not separated by distance, that a single device is responsible for both transmission and reception. Okay? The schematic is shown here for bistatic acquisition mode and for monostatic acquisition mode. Monostatic means transmitter and receiver are not separated by distance, but then a single device is responsible for both transmission and reception as well. All right. Now, while we discussed about single pass interferometry, please be aware that there can also be something known as a repeat pass interferometry. Repeat pass. See, having, you know, two instruments on board the same platform, the same satellite, can lead to weight restrictions or increase in cost, because of which an alternative can be decided based upon the form of repeat pass interferometry, you know. So, an example I can give you is Biomass, which is an Earth observing satellite which is planned for launch in the year 2023 by the European Space Agency. It shall use repeat pass interferometry. So, the difference is that here two measurements are made using different overpasses of the same instrument, different overpasses of the same instrument. Now, we have discussed about single pass interferometry, repeat pass interferometry. There can also be a multi-pass interferometry, which is possible when multiple passes of the same instrument can be used to collect information, multiple passes. Okay. So, now let us understand a little bit about a cross-track interferometry, for which a detailed geometry is being shown here. So, here assume this is the ground surface, okay, and assume X is an elevated point on the ground surface. Here you can see two antennas, antenna 1 and antenna 2. Their distance from the point X is represented as range 1, that is R1, and range 2, that is R2. Look angle is shown here, that is theta L. Say our aim is to estimate the height of the point X from a reference surface. Remember, the reference surface can either be an average terrain height or it can be a datum like MSL, mean sea level. All right. So, now we know what is theta L, what is alpha, what is baseline distance, what is R1 and what is R2, isn't it? Towards your right side, there are given different across track Insar configurations just for your understanding. That is, we can have single pass with two active antennas, single pass with only one active antenna, but then two receiving antennas, dual pass using single antenna and multi-pass using single antenna. So, they are just different across track Insar configurations. So, we have just understood the geometry of across track interferometry. Assume that the surface is not changing across the temporal baseline. So, we know that theta L is the look angle, R1 and R2 are the range distances from antenna 1 and antenna 2 to the point X, which is an elevated point on the ground surface. And we know that the phase difference that will be measured between two sources for a given look angle shall be related to the path length difference, which I am going to denote as delta R, which is going to be R2 minus R1 for a single pass interferometry. But then for a repeat pass interferometry, wherein two measurements are required using different overpasses of the same instrument, delta R can be represented as 2 into R2 minus R1. Okay? Again, I can write the phase difference as delta phi equal to 2 pi delta r by lambda, and this in turn I can write it as k multiplied by delta r, where k is nothing but the wave number. Okay? Remember that we can represent the absolute phase difference, we can represent it in the form of delta r equal to baseline distance, baseline multiplied by sine of alpha minus theta l. Okay? Moving on. Now, remember that our aim is to ultimately use the signals of synthetic aperture radar image pixels, take their phase difference and then estimate the look angle, that is the direction to that pixel, look angle. And once we know the look angle of a pixel, we can estimate the true ground range and height, the true ground range and height. Now, please remember that we are measuring the relative phase difference here, not the absolute phase difference. So, the return echoes from the Earth's surface shall have a relative phase difference, which can be represented as an image called as interferogram that you see in the screen in front of you, interferogram. It looks like this. It's a colorful image which shows the phase value of each area on the ground surface. So, instead of using variations of black and white, interferograms are colored, wherein the lines of equal color are called as fringes, fringes, lines of equal color, fringes. Okay? And for upslope, the fringes shall be closer together, whereas for downslope, the fringes shall be far apart. Okay? Now, once we have obtained the interferogram, what next? So, the next step is to convert the phase differences into look angle and to height above a reference surface. And this is performed so that the final product is in a standard geographical coordinate system. This is also called as flat earth interferogram. So, remember, we have a measured interferogram, we have a flat earth interferogram, and you are subtracting to create a flat earth corrected interferogram. Okay? Please remember that still now we are not aware about the absolute phase difference. Okay? And to estimate topography of the terrain, the absolute phase difference is required, it is essential. Now, if the fringes are in cycles of 2 pi, every time the phase reaches 2 pi, it is going to be reset to 0, isn't it? Let me reiterate, say the fringes are in cycles of 2 pi, every time the phase is reaching 2 pi, say for even a small amount of phase above 2 pi, even then it is going to be reset to 0. And such an interferogram is called as wrapped, because whenever it is reaching 2 pi, it is going to wrap again to 0, wrapped. Okay? The concept of a wrapped image is shown here. So, in other words, at any instant when the phase values are greater than 2 pi, the phase resets to 0. As relative phase difference is only being measured and not the absolute phase difference, we need a way to estimate the absolute phase difference, which means we need to do phase unwrapping, phase unwrapping. Okay? In phase unwrapping, we assume that the terrain is continuous such that every time the phase is counted to a value greater than 2 pi, even by a small increment of delta, the phase shall be reassigned as 2 pi by delta. And this process is carried out till the next cycle is reached, that is 4 pi. Again, for any further increment in delta, phases will be reassigned as 4 pi by delta and so on. So, you see the difference in the concept of unwrapped image and the concept of wrapped image, isn't it? Okay. So, you have understood the basic terminologies that are required for processing a single look complex image. So, these are the steps that you will be following as part of the tutorial, that is for INSAR processing. We start with a single look complex or SLC data or a raw unprocessed SAR image. We perform something known as a co-registration. See, in INSAR there are terminologies of master image and slave image, and these refer to different images being used for co-registration such that the master image always remains unchanged. Okay. Now, after co-registration, the next step is generation of interferogram, and after that it is phase unwrapping, and finally it is to infer pixel heights. Okay, pixel heights. Now, let us try to quickly understand how to interpret an interferogram, because in a few slides before I just showed you a colorful interferogram. We did not actually learn how to interpret it. So, assume this figure represents how land surface displacement is represented, and assume each fringe or each color cycle is say 18 millimeters of range change. Okay? And to interpret an interferogram, we have to count the number of fringes between two points in an interferogram, where one fringe is one complete cycle. For example, say you are focusing on this area that is within the circle. You have to count the number of fringes between two points in an interferogram where one fringe is one complete cycle. So, between blue to blue, it is going to represent 18 millimeters. So, 2 fringes is going to be 18 plus 18. Again, in a region with upslope, the fringes will be close together, it will become squeezed together. And in a downslope region, the fringes shall appear stretched apart, okay, stretched apart from one another. Okay. Interpreting an interferogram. Okay. Let me leave you with two more terminologies for this lecture. You know, can we take two SAR complex imagery that is captured from two different flight path and simply subtract the phase value of image 1 with the phase value of image 2 to produce an interferogram? Is that how it is done? You pick two SAR complex imagery, subtract the phase of image 1 with the phase of image 2, will that give an interferogram? So, then my question is, what happens to the area of radar shadow? Remember, when we discussed in detail about image distortions, we covered a term known as radar shadow, that is a silent zone wherein you get no measurement from a radar shadow region, isn't it? Now, we need some means to discriminate meaningful measurements when the phase differences share information about the geometry rather than the noise. Okay? That is, the phase difference should make sense, they should not be all noise. In radar interferometry, we use an expression to estimate coherence of an image, coherence of an image. I am introducing you to one more new terminology, that is coherence of an image. Say, we have two single look complex pixel values. N is the number of pixels, and let I1 and I2 be the SLC complex pixel values. For estimating coherence, we assume that across a small window, the image surface properties shall remain constant. Okay? This is the expression that gives you coherence. Sigma n I1 into I2 the whole by root of sigma n I1 square sigma n I2 square. Now, before I move forward, please understand that the phase angle gives phase differences, phase angle of coherence gives phase differences, and the magnitude gives a measure of meaningfulness of measurement, okay, how meaningful the measurement is. Now, as the magnitude gives us the quality of correlation, it is also sometimes called as the degree of coherence. Okay? Alright. Now, before I move forward, let me quickly display a set of stereo images in front of you. Okay? Stereo pairs of images showing the basalt cliffs of Argentina from NASA site. To view the stereo pairs as it is written, cross eyes slightly until a third white dot appears between the two. I will give it some time. Are you able to see the center image which is in 3D? Try to cross eyes slightly until a third white dot appears between the two white dots. Are you able to see the new center image which is in 3D? So, this cross-eyed image was generated using the topographic data from Shuttle Radar Topography Mission SRTM plus the Landsat 7 images. Here you look at two perspectives of the same image using one for each eye, isn't it? And in the process, the image shall appear to be shifted slightly depending on its elevation, giving you a vertical view of the Earth's surface in three dimensions. Now, the reason I am showing you this image is because while we discussed about Insar, we did mention that it is used to create high resolution ground topography. But then please note that there are other means of extracting topographic information from synthetic aperture radar imagery, and one such method is known as stereo SAR radar grammetry. Okay? I will leave you with the last new term of this lecture, that is stereo SAR radar grammetry. Shown here is the geometry of stereo SAR radar grammetry, wherein there are two antennas, the baseline separation between the two antennas, R1 and R2 are the range distances of an elevated point x. The ground surface is shown in the brown colored line and the reference surface is shown in the black colored line. H is the height of the point x from the reference surface. Now, this reference surface, remember, it can be an average terrain height or it can be a datum like the mean sea level. Okay. The look angle is also given here, theta L. Now, if you watch closely, you can note that the same point on the surface of the earth, that is x, is projected to two distinct locations on the reference surface, that is x1 2 dash and x2 2 dash. The same point x, it is projected into two distinct locations on the reference surface. Now, the difference between these two points is proportional to the height of the point above the reference surface, And by measuring R1 minus R2, we can estimate the surface height. Let us try to understand this through a derivation. Please note that the two images from two antennas are acquired with a separation known as a baseline. We know what is R1, we know what is R2, we know what is baseline distance and what is theta L, that is the look angle. We can use the cosine rule and write an expression R1 square equal to R2 square plus baseline distance square minus 2 into R2 into baseline into cos of 90 minus theta L plus alpha. We are using the cosine rule here. Okay, you know what is R1 and R2, range distances of antenna 1 and antenna 2. We know what is baseline, we know what is theta L, we know what is alpha, cosine rule. Now, what I will do is I will further rearrange this expression a little bit such that I get cos of theta L minus alpha equal to R1 square minus R2 square minus baseline square by 2 into R2 into baseline. So, theta L is going to be cos inverse this expression plus alpha, is not it? To estimate H, we are assuming that the baseline angle, that is alpha, is known, such that we can write H equal to, isn't it? Now remember, R1 is known, H is nothing but a flight parameter, which means you can estimate small h once you know H R1 theta L. And theta L, that is the look angle, can be estimated once you know R1, R2, that difference and baseline. Okay. So, what we discussed was the geometry of stereo SAR radar grammetry. So, let us try to summarize what we learnt as part of today's lecture. So, today we understood about INSAR, that is interferometric SAR, and then we covered a few terminologies that are required for us to understand about INSAR. We understood how INSAR can give us topographic information about the Earth's surface. We saw the different modes of acquisition of data: single pass interferometry, repeat pass interferometry and multi pass interferometry. And we also understood that baseline is the separation distance between the two antennas. Further, we also tried to understand about coherence of an image. We tried to interpret an interferogram, and we also understood the different INSAR processing steps. And we finally understood that INSAR is not the only method that can give us topographic information from SAR. We also have stereo SAR radar grammetry. So, let me hope that you could understand what was covered as part of today's lecture, and I will meet you in the next class. Thank you.